Okay, I'm live. Okay, hi everyone. I'm Dr. Supriya, your GOQii doctor, and my show is called The Good Doctor Show. And as I told you earlier, I am a cosmetologist and a general practitioner as well. So any queries that you'll have, of course, you can always shoot it in. And I'm waiting for some people to come live. Okay. So today we're having a topic on herpes and chickenpox, basically, and what is the difference between these things. And like, people know it as chickenpox and people know it as herpes, and hence we have called it two different things. So we're going to be discussing more about chickenpox and herpes. Of course, y'all are always free to ask us any questions y'all want to. As you already know, that we have started off with our step challenge today. India step challenge has started today. And I hope some of you all have actually joined us and been a part of it as well. So let me see what is happening with you all as well. Okay, I have my computer in just in case. I always write down stuff in my computer, basically. I sometimes can't read my own handwriting, so I don't have a piece of paper with me. Thank you so much. As you can see, a lot of likes, which I'm very happy about. It's been ages since I've seen so many hearts and people are like throwing it out. It's so good to see that. Makes me very happy. Thank you. So whoever joined in, I just want to ask you all, if you all do know something about chickenpox, or do you all know something about herpes? Like, how many of y'all have actually got chickenpox? So y'all do know, or your children have got chickenpox in the recent time, or what is that y'all know about chickenpox? Anything small, anything that y'all know. Because per se, it will become a very lecture session if I just speak about herpes and chickenpox. I don't know how many people have questions for chickenpox actually. So let's have an interactive session today. Let's see what people know about chickenpox. Y'all can always drop in a hi to me, like, hello. Am I not getting messages? No, nobody's messaging me today. Okay, I think I've got like close to 600 people who've joined in. So I'm gonna start off with what is chickenpox and what is herpes, and what is the actual discussion that we want to have today. So chickenpox is a type of herpes. Okay, herpes is in a whole. It is like swine flu, and swine flu has multiple type of viruses inside itself. Herpes similarly has 8 type of viruses within itself. One of the virus which gives you chickenpox is called as varicella zoster virus. Hi, Mr. Sharma. I don't know, G. Sharma. I don't know if it's a Mr. or a Miss. I'm sorry. So herpes has 8 such viruses, and within its virus, one of the virus is called as varicella zoster virus. Okay. So this particular virus is going to cause chickenpox. Now, as we know, and most of us must have had chickenpox as we were growing older, because we did not have probably the vaccines during our time. So I guess, hi Ramesh Kunnar, hi Mandeep, hi Ramesh, hi Meenal. Thanks for joining, all of you. Thank you so much for joining. Okay. So should I wait or I'll continue? I think I can see a lot of people. I like the fact that people are so interested in knowing what is herpes and what is chickenpox. Okay, so you have something called as chickenpox. You have something called as herpes. Herpes has 8 particular viruses, out of which one is varicella zoster virus, which is basically the chicken pox virus. Okay, so as kids, we must have obviously all of us have, most of us have got chicken pox basically, but you don't hear the same happening nowadays in our kids. Yeah, because there are vaccines also which are available, and it is not creating as much of a complication as it was earlier creating. So we are in a better place when it comes to chicken pox. So chicken pox is basically an airborne disease. So basically, even if I have chicken pox or if a kid has chicken pox, and if the kid sneezes also, and that virus can come to me. And if I have never got chicken pox or if my immunity is low, then the chances of me getting that is very high. Okay, so this is the basic thing about chicken pox. This particular virus of chicken pox is spread through the airborne, that is air droplets. Basically, so even if that person sneezes, and this particular virus can even spread even before the rash comes on their skin. So you are pretty much aware that chicken pox means rash, means a lot of you have these pinkish rashes which start, like they look like mosquito bites all over the body, and they eventually will start having some form of fluid inside it, okay, and that fluid will eventually burst and a crust is formed. Okay, so this is the basic action of a chicken pox. All of these part of it are basically they are communicable, so they can spread. So if that particular fluid also touches you, you also can get the chicken pox. If say till the crust is completely formed, you are also equally, you also have a chance of getting chicken pox if you don't have good immunity, or if you have earlier not got chicken pox earlier in your life. Okay, so that is how chicken pox happens in kids. Okay, hi Ashish, hi Anuja, hi Ashish, okay, hi Kamlesh. Okay, so I have, this is the broad thing about chicken pox. A chicken pox virus, even if it's not around you right away, can spread between 20 to 14 days. So they have an incubation period. So you could meet somebody who had chicken pox, say 14 days back, and then that could start showing in your, that could start showing on you after 10 to 14 days as well. Okay, so chicken pox tends to have that kind of an incubation period. What we call this an incubation period. Incubation period means if it's got transferred to you, how long is it going to take for the virus to grow inside you and then to start showing results. Okay, so that is one thing about incubation period. Hi Mr. Sunil. Now what is the other herpes? Okay, so there's something called as nagin that all of us have heard about, or it's called as shingles in the other form of chicken pox. So they say that once you grow older, if you've not got chicken pox in a younger age, kids who get chicken pox and have good immunity as well, like overall they're not very they don't have a very bad immunity, they don't tend to get bad chicken pox. In the terms, they don't get into too many complication. Of course, it itches a lot, but if you tend to put like calamine lotion or something on, they don't tend to have, for the chicken pox, they don't actually have to go ahead and do something major. Okay, like they don't have to like really require a lot of treatment behind it. They don't need an antiviral treatment or something. Sunil, herpes depends on which herpes you have. So I'm just going to come to that as well. So it is basically affects a dermatome. So if each part of our body has a certain dermatome. So I'm now going to talk about the terms called nagin, or what is called as shingles, or which is called as herpes zoster basically. So what you hear is you've got herpes zoster, which is not the one which is transmitted via an STD. That is, it's not a sexually transmitted disease. Not everybody who has herpes has sexually transmitted disease. There are two different types of herpes. One of the herpes would be a non-sexually transmitted disease. So that herpes basically is because of, for example, I have had chickenpox in a younger age. Okay. Now when I grow old, and now when I will have some kind of, say my immunity just suddenly comes down, or if I'm having some kind of steroids because of which my immunity is drastically coming down. In such cases, the one that chickenpox which I had earlier is just sitting as a dormant, like it's just sitting, not relaxing, not doing anything at all. When my immunity comes down, it starts to overreact and it will start forming a what do you say? It will start getting active again, okay? And when it becomes active at an older age, it takes a side of a dermatome. A dermatome means each one of our part has a nerve which supplies to a particular ending. So every nerve ending, so we have multiple nerves. One of the nerves will, the last bit of the nerve supplies a certain stretch of the skin, okay, for example. And hence, what this particular herpes will now do is it's going to just go on that dermatome. It's just going to affect that particular nerve side of it. The nervous system of that particular nerve is going to be affected. And hence, it appears like a snake in some of us because our dermatomes are literally straight. I'll just show you all the dermatomes of our body. Oh, I'm just going to show you an image. Okay. Okay, now this. Okay, you can see these things. So each of our spinal of our spine has each one of them basically have a dermatome. Okay, so this is particular, this is what it is. So for example, this is by T1, this is by T4. Okay, you don't have to know the details of it, but I'm just saying whatever spinal cord nerve supply is there, it will just go and affect that particular side of it. And hence it's called as Nakin because it appears like a snake. It appears like a type of a snake. So that is a different kind of herpes. That herpes is non-sexually transmitted disease. Okay, now you have another category which is very commonly seen as genital, or basically some people get on their lips, which is called as oral herpes zoster, or herpes is what you hear it. Now that is a different type of herpes. That herpes is basically herpes simplex virus. It's an altogether different virus. Of course, you don't need to know the virus. But the concept is it's a different virus. It is transmitted through a sexually transmitted disease. They are generally mixed with syphilis, and you have all the other sexually transmitted diseases because of which you have a very similar looking outlook. That is basically a sexually transmitted disease. So some of them will get on the mouth and some of them will obviously get in the genital area. So that is a different herpes altogether. Okay. So there are the three main herpes. When someone says that they've got herpes, it should not always be thought it's a sexually transmitted ones or isne kuch to kiya iske liye hua. The different types, one needs to understand that as well. Of course, in the adulthood, it is very painful. It gets extremely difficult to bear with it. You do feel like someone is continuously picking on you. And even it's a very painful procedure when it comes to getting this particular thing when you're an adult. You will get this chickenpox in adulthood when you have never got chickenpox in your childhood. But if your child gets chickenpox, then even you have chances of getting chickenpox as well. The other thing is that pregnancy is a major issue. If you are pregnant, then you must stay away from people who've had chickenpox because your immunity in itself is very low and you have to be more careful during that time. So that is one thing one needs to take into account as to be more careful. Of course, HIV patients, people who are immunocompromised, who've got cancer and who are on immunotherapy, basically their immunity goes on a toss and it becomes a problem to them. So then they will have a shingles kind of a looking chicken pox is how we would call it. So that is what herpes in general is, and it is subdivided into different types. The most common being chickenpox. Then you have you have STD related chickenpox or herpes, and then you have your normal atoli shingles or what we call as Nagin. Okay. Hi Sadhana, hi Nagrajan. Okay. So this is an overview of what chickenpox is. Does anybody have any questions for me? Or let me see if I have missed out any points as well. Okay, you do have nowadays, you do get chickenpox virus ka vaccination available, and of course this can be administered in kids as well, and it is it's not painful, of course, and it is not a problematic thing. You can have your child get chickenpox in a younger age, but there are two schools of thoughts for it, because some people believe that a kid getting chickenpox in an earlier stage of life, it is more helpful than someone who gets it in their adulthood. Vaccination just pushes it forward but does not stop the chickenpox happening at an adulthood stage. So it's a controversial thought, but yes, you do have vaccination available. Okay, so how would you know that you have it? Of course, it would be a rash would be there, loss of appetite would be there, fever is associated with that, itching is there, and you have, because of the fever, a general feeling of tiredness is also there. This happens in case of chickenpox. You see your kid is feeling tired, not feeling energetic, seeing some small rashes, fever is there. And in such cases, of course, you can go get in touch with their school and the school will inform you somebody has had chickenpox as well. So it is a communicable disease. It spreads through the nose, meaning air droplets. So even if I cough, even if I sneeze, and if I had that particular virus in me, it's going to spread across. Okay, so that is the meaning of air droplet borne diseases. Of course, the disease spreads till the entire crust of it is dried off and is no more affecting the body. Okay. For some people, the problem happens in the eye. The eye generally gets affected, and that's where one of the major complications starts. But other than that, there is no major issue of a chicken pox. I told you, as in kids, it just goes off without even realizing. But if they don't have good immunity, that's where the problem starts. Okay, I think I have covered my topic of chickenpox and herpes. So I'm just going to reiterate the entire thing. Some people also get this herpes because of fever as well, and that's also herpes simplex. It will mimic something like an STD, but it is not an STD. It is just basically because of the fever. Some people get that particular soreness around the lips. And that's also normal, so that should not be confused with an STD disease. Of course, your doctor is going to help you find out if it was STD or not an STD disease, because the treatment protocol are obviously different for both of them. So yeah, generally chickenpox, once chickenpox, you are immune to chickenpox. It acts like a vaccine. But if your immunity reduces because of some or the other reason, as I told you, in case of a chemotherapy or in case of any other issues like, of course, HIV is a part of it. If you have been on immunotherapy, if you have, in general, your immunity reduces, then there's a chance that this chicken pox will now appear as shingles in adulthood. It appears as shingles or what we call as nagin. Very rarely do people get chicken pox twice. It is very rare condition that people will get. You'll get once and you'll get it once again. So yeah, it just happens once. Okay, so I'm going to reiterate the entire thing. What is chicken pox? What is herpes? Herpes is the mother of it. Hi, Mr. PP. Okay, herpes is the main thing. Okay, and herpes ke below is, there are 8 types of viruses within herpes, and out of which one is chickenpox, okay, which is called as varicella zoster virus, okay, and then you have your other viruses as well. The important ones to know is, of course, varicella, and the other one you must know is the herpes simplex virus, which is basically the one which is caused because of STD, which is sexually transmitted disease. Okay, now the one that you have because of chickenpox is basically the one that you get in childhood, okay, and you get these childhood ones when you have this. Obviously, you know that there is the rash is there, the fever is there, the not wanting to eat is there, all of that is a part of the symptoms when it comes to chicken pox. Chicken pox basically generally starts from your head downwards, but sometimes it spreads on your face. It is a communicable disease. Communicable, that means it is going to get transferred from one person to another. The medium for transport of chicken pox is air droplets. That means even if I sneeze, if I cough and I shake your hands, and if you tend to do something with your mouth again, you are going to get chicken pox. If you've never got it earlier in childhood is what I'm talking about. So kids get it that way. They're playing, they're coughing, they're doing all of that, and that's how they get it. The incubation period is between 2 days to close to between 2 days to close to 10 to 14 days. So if your kid has got it today, the chances that the kid might show that it's got chicken pox is going to be another 10 to 14 days. Okay, so that's how long the incubation period is. Incubation period means that your body is basically harvesting the particular virus and it's growing inside your body. It takes that long. Generally, in kids who have good immunity, it is still going to show, but it's not going to hurt anything. It's not going to have any major complications at all. It max to max, in some cases, it does affect the nose and it becomes a pneumonia case. Of course, if it affects the eye, it can become a problem, but most of the cases is not at all a problem. For some of us, even though we don't, the marks are also not there anymore. So per se, it gets off by itself. It has a course. Generally, a doctor will not prescribe a medicine as your kid is young. And just immunity is the only thing for your kid. Okay, so even if your immunity is very good, you will still get chicken pox. But if you've never got chicken pox, okay, there are two things now. You've had chicken pox at a younger age. And now once you grow older, your immunity has, for example, suddenly dropped off because of any reason, say chemotherapy. You've taken some drugs which reduce your immunity, steroids, basically intake of steroids. All of this is just suddenly going to drop your immunity. In that case, the virus earlier, which were in your body, act as, some of them remain in your body and they act as dormant. I mean, they're just sitting, they're doing nothing at all. And then suddenly when your immunity is reduced, they will just suddenly wake up and they'll start to spread across. This basically is called as nagin or shingles. Okay, that's what we get in adulthood. The reason why it's called that a nagin is because, it has a dermatome. Okay, so this is basically the dermatomes. Mr. Ayush, I think I would have to ask someone to ignore you and basically block you. I don't get this point of what you're trying to discuss in this particular session. Just because we talk about it does not mean you can speak whatever you want to speak. So this is a lecture or this is a session in which we discuss important concepts. I think what you've written is absolutely rubbish. Okay, so those are dermatomes. The dermatomes basically I'm like so angry at this Ayush. I don't know how to speak. Okay, so dermatomes are basically in your spinal cord, each one of them. Each, as you know, we have C1, C2, C3, C4, as called as cervical. Then you have thoracic. Then you have the lumbar and the sacrum one. So you have T1, T2, T3, like that. You have L1, L2, L3. That's basically your spinal cord. Your spinal cord then comes out. And each one of them are going to for each part of your body, they're going to have a dermatome, which they're going to supply the nerve endings to. Shingles will basically affect these dermatomes and hence they appear like snake. Okay. Yeah, that is one thing. So, yeah. Okay, thankfully that guy has deleted the particular post. Okay, so that is the thing about dermatomes. I told you that's the reason why it appears. It is pretty much painful in adulthood and it does hurt pretty bad in adulthood, so one needs to be more careful. And so that's about shingles. Then you have something called a sexually transmitted disease. This is the STD. STDs are altogether different type of a virus and they affect you differently. They basically affect the genitals area of the men or the women. Sometimes they do have it in the oral areas as well. Oral ones can also be in case of fever. Okay, so even some people who have fever as well get herpes, but that herpes virus is altogether different. So not all the ones which come on the face or the mouth are basically STDs, but yes, the genital ones are STDs. They can't be of anything else. Okay, Mandeep. So I'm guessing your child is all right, Mr. Mandeep. Okay. So did your wife get it, Mandeep? Because if your child has never had it when she, if your wife never had it while she was a child, it was better off that she would have stayed away from the child. But of course, being the mother, she would have to bear through it. So there's a chance that if she's never got in her childhood and if her immunity is low, then she might get a chance. Then there's a chance of her getting it too. But otherwise, if her immunity is all right, the chances of her getting are pretty low. So you need not worry. But yeah, if she also gets in, you should stay away and the kid should again stay away, because the kid could carry the virus with her, you know, with her while she goes to school. So that is very important. Okay. Okay, any other questions anybody has for me? I hope I have helped you all out. It's been a good session and of course interactive. So she's had it as a young person. The chances of her getting are very low. She just has to make it a point that her, like she eats good amount of food and she's doing her thing well. Because while she's taking care of her kid, she should not be ignoring her own food pattern. So she is good. If she's got it as a kid, then the chances of her getting are very, very, very low. So they need not worry about that, Mandeep. Okay, so I'm going to take your leave. I hope I have helped you a lot today. Tomorrow morning, we're going to have a special session again on dandruff. Okay. Apurva is asking, I've had mumps in the past. What are the chances of getting? So mumps are altogether different disease. It's a different type of a virus. So mumps, measles, rubella, different type altogether. And that of chickenpox is altogether. So just because you have had mumps earlier does not mean you will not get chickenpox. Chickenpox virus is in itself a very different thing. But Apurva, if you, like, of course, you're above 18 years of age, and if you've never got chickenpox, you might as well stay away from people who've got chickenpox or somebody you know who's got chickenpox. But you need to keep your immunity all right, and you will not get a chance of having chickenpox per se. The genital one is altogether different. Those chances can come even multiple times. Like, it's not like the thing about the genital herpes is that even if you get it once, you can't assume you will not get it again. So that in that case, you have to be more careful if someone has genital one is what I'm talking about. And if you want to stay away from somebody who has a genital herpes, then in that case, you need to stay away because you can get recurrent ones when it comes to the genital herpes. But something like a chicken pox or the shingles, very rarely do people get a second episode. So yeah. Okay. So I'm going to take your leave and thank you so much for your time. And I have had a very good session with you all. Of course, there was an idiot in between all of us, but it's all gone now. So thank you so much for your time. So I was talking about tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning at 11:30, I think a lot of people had some queries about dandruff all over again. So we are having a special session on Saturday tomorrow morning at 11:30 to discuss about dandruff issues. And I hope to see some of y'all, whoever not obviously been there earlier and want to see it again, of course. And we can again have an interactive session. So please be there tomorrow morning, 11:30. We're discussing about dandruff. Of course, as always, we have a lot of doctors. We have Dr. Paramjeet, we have Dr. Ashwin, who are also on board and who discuss about different health issues. They discuss mainly about the body in terms of you know, you have like your liver, lung, all of those things, the male part of it, both of them are discussing. I basically am handling the women health, the skin, the hair. So if you'll ever think that there should be another topic that should be added on, please bring it on and let us know, and we will want to discuss more about it. We are more than happy to get suggestions from all of y'all as to what should be the more topics, what else would I want to hear about is what we really care about. So yes, we are here to help you all out, and I'm so happy that you all do enjoy our sessions. We love it that all of y'all are so interactive with us, and we are very appreciative about it. So genuinely, thank you for your time. You'll spend half an hour of your day with me. It's a very good feeling for me, and I'm very happy to be here for y'all. So thank you so much. As I always say, do one act of gratitude every day if y'all can. Be kind to one another. That's the least we can all do. And with GOQii, be the force. So it's like, get back on working out and be living a good life. We are not about y'all falling sick. We want you all to be safe from falling sick and, you know, have a better life altogether. And whatever life we live, we want to be extremely healthy. So please take care of yourselves. And thank you so much for your time. And goodbye for now.